One year ago, in 2012, the Filipino people watched the fate of former Chief Justice Renato Corona hang in the balance. After 13 weeks, that's 44 trial days, Corona became the first Philippine official to be convicted and removed by an impeachment court, all for his failure to disclose all his assets as mandated by law. The nation saw the fall of the chief of the highest court of the land, the so-called last bulwark of democracy.
Now, 1 year on, what has changed? How has the trial affected the morale of the High Court? More importantly, how has it affected the way the institution does its business? Many say the Corona impeachment trial was a defining moment in our history. But did we really learn our lesson?
And for our discussion, we're joined here in the studio by investigative journalist Marites Vitug.
She is, of course, also the author of Hour Before Dawn, which chronicles the darkest hour of the Supreme Court. And you can join our discussion by sending us your comments and questions through Twitter. Use the hashtag PrimeTime or post your thoughts on her Facebook page. That's ANC247. Marites, nice to see you again, and thanks for joining us tonight.
Hi, good evening. Thank you for inviting me.
Thank you, Marites. What have you been doing since the impeachment?
I think it will take another 18 years before we see the impact. No, I'm just joking. Well, I've been trying to watch the court, but from a distance, not on a day-to-day or very intense basis.
So you haven't done any extensive research right after the Chief Justice was replaced?
No, I just follow it from sources, from the news. And it's been a very interesting year for the Supreme Court. I say interesting because we saw some resistance to the new Chief Justice, and you could see the leaks given to one newspaper. You could see leaks, some inaccurate, I guess, or some accurate against the Chief Justice. So there was a kind of the first few months there was terrible resistance from the justices. Now it's quieted down a bit.
Because it was obvious from the get-go when the Chief Justice Serrano came in that there were there was a faction, I guess, that was still loyal to Chief Justice Corona, who wouldn't give her an easy time as a CJ.
Yeah, or maybe loyal to former President Arroyo.
Okay.
Or associated. Or identified. But now we're seeing that this is the feedback we get from inside is that they're more circumspect now. I think they learned their lessons, and some were scared, or I think they feared that they would also be impeached, because there was a lot of noise, remember, during the impeachment, that this will not be the last time. So it's been quiet.
So is it really loyal to the former president, loyal to the institution, or loyal to the secrets that they still hold up to now?
You know, in our culture, when the president appoints you, sometimes there's this utang na loob or this sense of gratitude, but it shouldn't be the case. Once you're appointed there because you deserve it, it's based on merit, and you should do your job as an independent justice of the Supreme Court. But we didn't see that in many cases. So hopefully that will be the thinking of any appointed to the Supreme Court.
Now, when you were writing your book, your first book, Shadow of Doubt, you were saying already that it was a difficult process to get whatever documents you needed from the Supreme Court. After the impeachment trial of Chief Justice Corona, people were expecting there would be more transparency from the High Court. Do you also observe that as happening now?
Yeah. After Corona was convicted, like a day or two after, we saw on the Supreme Court website their financial reports, their audit reports, but it's still not complete. We still need to see more of these reports. And then they decided to release their asset statements. But now we're surprised because we've been requesting for the SALENs again for this year, and we haven't received any copy since more than 4 months.
Kailan ang deadline ng filing?
April. No, but we requested for the old one. But the Chief Justice, after the appointment, is mandated by law to submit a new SALN.
Right.
So we were also requesting that.
And
so I'm just thinking, have they forgotten the lessons of the Corona conviction? Or is this just going back to the old bureaucracy?
Now you tell me, you know the answer to that. You've been a Supreme Court observer, and you know their ways. Is it either of the two? Is it, you know, just forgetting the lessons learned, or is it really just going back to the old ways?
Maybe it's overwhelming, I think, for the new Chief Justice. She's quite junior, and then she met a lot of resistance. Remember that she tried to reform the Supreme Court by decentralizing, which is good, because Supreme Court is really very centralized. No, a justice in Tawi-Tawi receives his check from Manila. Mm-hmm. Anyway, it's too centralized, so she tried to decentralize, but there was something. The justices protested because she wasn't consultative enough, or she did not reflect the sentiment of mm-hmm. majority of the justices in wanting more, detailed mm-hmm. consultation, etc., mm-hmm. etc. Mm-hmm. So that stalled the reform. Mm-hmm. So I think learning from that, Chief Justice Sereno is more careful now, more cautious, but she's proceeding with declogging the dockets. But it will take some time.
But then how does that relate to, you know, not releasing the salaries? It's been close to 5 months.
Yeah, I was thinking it's overwhelming that maybe it was put in the last, at the bottom of the pile of requests. But I don't know. We've not been, our reporter has been following it up, and mm-hmm. there's been no request. So maybe we hope that they'll soon release the salaries.
Okay. Now, let's just go back to what former Chief Justice Renato Corona had said in his statement to mark the anniversary of the verdict in his impeachment trial. And he's saying it was a sham process, that is merely the action of a vindictive president who was out to get back at him for a decision, a ruling on the family's hacienda, Luisita. Up to this day, the former Chief Justice believes that's the only underlying reason behind his impeachment. What do you feel?
Yeah, it's understandable that he thinks that way, because otherwise he cannot maintain his innocence. Mm-hmm. No? If we look back at the Hacienda Luisita case, it's not true that he was for outright distribution. In the beginning, he was very cautious about it. He changed his mind later. So I look at that, and I wrote about it in Hour Before Dawn, and he wasn't really committed to genuine change in land reform. Hmm. He only changed his mind later when he saw that it was the popular thing to do. Hmm. So that can be debunked.
Mm-hmm. So do you feel that perhaps even though the senators gave the reasons for why they voted either to convict or to acquit, that there was no real justice given to the Chief Justice, that they can still contest the results of that trial?
No, in fact, lawyers were saying at the time already that there could be 3 or 4 possible cases that could be filed against Corona. One is tax evasion. Mm-hmm. That has happened. Okay. The other is unexplained wealth or forfeiture of assets. Mm-hmm. That's still pending.
Right.
The other one is perjury, because he lied in his salen, mm-hmm. but there's no such case. Mm-hmm. I forgot the other one. Mm-hmm. But it was very clear. I mean, without the power of the impeachment court to subpoena, we wouldn't have known this, because mm-hmm. the salens were secret. We couldn't get bank records.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
No, so I think it's very clear. I think what we need to know now is where did this all come from?
Mm. Because I think even during the course of the impeachment trial, the question was whether the prosecution had built its case mm-hmm. against the Chief Justice properly, yes. given that there were, 7 accusations, 7 charges that they had filed against him, only to drop the others and stick with just one. Still leaves some doubt at the back of the minds of many that the prosecution never really did its job well. Chinambahan lang nila na convict si Chief Justice.
That's true. They were unprepared, because they thought that, like Ombudsman Gutierrez, who resigned before
they could impeach her.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, before the trial, before they even went to the trial,
yes,
right?
Yes.
So they thought it was going to be the same scenario. Mm-hmm.
But he submitted himself to the process.
So, and we saw how unprepared they were. Yun lang nahanapan ng butas, yung salen. So, you know, the salen really is really very important kasi it will be a leveler among public officials. A lowly employee and a top employee can be convicted because of lying in SALN or not declaring one's assets.
And the fact-checking that has to go now into the SALNs that have been submitted has to be more thorough because nobody accepts these SALNs at face value anymore.
Correct. That's true. In fact, during the campaign, it was an issue. Mm. Remember that some raised the issue of the SALN of Senator Legarda. And there was fact-checking, there were records. So I think that's one effect of the, that's one big effect of the impeachment and conviction.
Right.
But I remember, Marites, after the conviction happened, that we had an interview with you. And to paraphrase you, you basically said that this should not be about the Corona alone. That this is really about, you know, strengthening the institution, again, by way of reforms, by way of cases, if need be. Are you disappointed that no such case has been filed against the other justices? To make sure that they're all in line, because what's good for the goose is good for the gander.
President Aquino spent a lot of political capital on the impeachment of Corona. And another impeachment process against a justice didn't sit well, parang at that time, even with his allies in Congress. So I think the only way to improve the quality of the justices is really to start with a selection, but that's for the future. It's key. Is you choose based on merit, not on whom you know, not on the connections, not on lobbying. And we didn't see that really happen. We didn't see it happen all the time under President Aquino. So he's also guilty of choosing based on personal connections. But that's not the case because he did not know Chief Justice Sereno. And
he did not know.
He did not know her. So that's based on merit. But the others, there's some personal element. Oh, he did not know Bernabe as well. But there was some lobbying there.
Yeah, now at least when they're televising the interviews for nominees, mas nakakatulong din yun, di ba?
Yes, for the Supreme Court justices.
Yeah.
Yes, that helped us a lot understand the process.
And actually understand the candidates themselves.
The candidates, yes.
Because may kumisan, may mga tanong doon na mas revealing yung mga sagot eh.
Yeah, it became, actually, it was the first time again that we saw televised interviews of the nominees to the Supreme Court.
So
I hope that happens again.
It is a great sequel.
Actually,
you know, even if it is just a teaser for many, many more episodes.
As an offshoot of the impeachment trial, I guess people became more interested in how candidates to the highest bench in the land would actually be selected. And isa pang issue there is now, I think it's still pending, whether or not it's the Senate or Congress that has the right to have a representative in the JBC.
Correct, yes. But I hope the public remains interested, not only, you know, after the impeachment, but to continue watching the court, because it's when people forget that there might be some sliding back.
Well, remind us once again, because throughout the process, you know, people were glued, because it was really like one whole, again, telenovela, that real life drama that you're watching. But there still is that disconnect between the highest court of the land and the regular person. Why should he care that this is happening and that reforms should be made?
Because I think the public should care about the Supreme Court because they're the final arbiter. They're like the referee in a basketball game. You know, you need to be fair, credible. Otherwise, the game will not be... the results of the game, the victory or the defeat, will not be credible. So that's the kind of institution that we need, a fair, credible, to decide my cases or your cases. And I think it's a cliche, but justice delayed is justice denied. People become very frustrated when there's no justice. And I've heard this a lot of times, but I only realized it when I started to work on the book, to write my books on the Supreme Court, that indeed they are the soul and of the country. They're like, they're unelected. They're supposed to be on a pedestal. They're supposed to be, you know, gods. So I really thought that they set the directions for the country in terms of their laws and decisions.
So, which brings me to my next question. Do you feel that there has to be a balance somehow? Because in the past, they've been like gods, yes, on pedestals, yes, away from the public's eye. That, you know, it came to a point that we really didn't care about them anymore because, you know, they didn't have any value in our everyday, yes, lives. But now that you have reforms happening within, do you feel that they should connect more with the people but without sacrificing or compromising their ability to make decisions?
Yes. I'm a believer in transparency in the Supreme Court, no? What should be kept confidential only are their deliberations, because that's, mm-hmm, supposed to be sacred. You know, you cannot influence them. You're not supposed to know the discussions, sure, going on. But they should reveal how they spend the budget. That's public money. Okay. They should reveal how the loans that the Philippine government made for judicial reform, how they're being spent. Mm-hmm. Remember that was also one of the issues raised against Corona, not in the impeachment,
the JDF,
but by the World Bank.
Yes.
They raised some irregularities, mm-mm, in the use of the loan. Mm-mm. So everything that has to do with public funds should be scrutinized, should be transparent. Mm-mm. SALENs, audit reports. Mm-mm. And they have secret, they used to have secret accounts. Mm-hmm. These have not been revealed yet.
That you feel that that's how they should, yes, make themselves relevant the people's lives.
People should know that they're above board.
They have secret accounts?
No, the judiciary has a secret, it used to be secret, mm-hmm, has an account which came from their collections and from savings. But I think they opened part, they made this public.
Collections like from
legal
docket fees, case bonds.
That reached over a billion pesos or billions of,
really?
Pesos. Yeah.
Wow, I didn't know they could make that much money.
No, they put it in a separate account. But what I mean by secret is, even then, the budget department didn't know about this. Mm-mm. The COA didn't really know about this. Mm. So this should... This is part of what should be made public.
Mm. Now you were saying, Martes, that the deliberations in the course of how they, yeah, arrive at the decision should still be confidential. No? Mm. But then during the course of the trial, we actually, heard one of the justices mention how they arrived at a particular decision, mm, who was discussing an issue with whom and how they were reacting to it.
I think for... The justice in her dissent, that was Sereno's, mm-hmm, dissent, I think it, I really like that. I mean, because it showed how, it gave us a glimpse into how the justices were discussing, but not so much the merits
of the case,
uh-huh, but the process.
Right. Mm.
I think it was even another justice before Sereno, years before Sereno, also did this. She's not the first to do that.
Mm.
So it just points out the flaws in the process. But when it comes to the arguments, the merits, I don't think they were discussed.
And another revealing thing in the course of the trial was the fact that in the case, for example, of the Hubert Webb decision, mm-hmm, one of the chief justices would actually meet with, say, the complainant in the case,
yes,
diba?
Yes.
The petitioner, see, Mr. Lauro Visconde, and how that plays into the decision of the, yeah, Supreme Court. I wonder if it is like a course of doing business with the Supreme Court, yeah, nangyayari pa rin ngayon yun.
That's the thing. That's why it's important for the media, for the public, to point out unethical practices.
Mm-hmm.
Because that will influence the decision of the court.
Mm-hmm.
It's unethical to meet with litigants.
Mm.
It's unethical for them to visit you.
Mm.
Diba they call that chamber practice?
Yeah, but was the ethics of that incident brought to fore in the trial? Hindi naman, diba?
It was part of the complaint.
The complaint,
but it's... They say that is unethical
an impeachable offense.
Yeah, yeah. Is violation of ethics an impeachable offense?
Yeah, still in that.
But in other countries, if they violate ethics, they resign.
Yeah, because it's a matter of delicadeza naman, or propriety, sense of propriety.
So they take it upon themselves, they bow out of office.
Okay, right. But I wonder if it, during the course of ito pa rin, the post-corona Supreme Court, whether or not may mga dumadalaw-dalaw pa rin doon sa mga justices.
Baka they're more, I think they're more careful now. I think because
that doesn't,
yeah,
that
but
doesn't,
we haven't really watched on a daily basis.
Yeah.
But I'll just mention one case, maybe, like the son of Justice Velasco ran for re-election in Marinduque. So there's been no buzz about so far about him being present there, or unlike in the past, because that's a gray area yan eh. As a Supreme Court justice, you're not supposed to be involved in campaigns. Mm-mm. But if the candidate happens to be your son,
member,
what do you do? Mm-mm. Still, you don't. You know, you don't make it visible. So this time around, I tried asking, and there's no buzz about him being there physically and being visible. But we don't know what's happening behind the scenes.
Now, after post-conviction, the Supreme Court sort of took a step back and adopted this whole idea of what they call the dignified silence. Do you feel that still should be the case up to now, many months after the conviction? Is it helping the Supreme Court but hurting the public? What's your take on that?
Dignified silence doesn't mean that, for me, dignified silence only means that you don't talk to the press face to face and you give interviews, but you should make all your documents, public documents, transparent. Sal-ens, public financials, how do you spend your money? That's the more basic. Because the decisions speak for themselves.
Right.
When you read the decisions, then you can ask your questions, but this is how the court speaks. But they shouldn't hide from the public the public interest issues. Like, again, it's really important that they keep their integrity, you know, how they spend the public funds.
To akin naman, on a closing note, because we actually saw in Anthony Taberna's report, Maridos Marquez, I mean, you know, he's been a regular fixture in the Supreme Court until he was replaced as court administrator.
No, he's still court administrator.
As spokesperson, I'm sorry.
So
Teddy Te is the Supreme Court spokesperson now. Would you feel that the kind of loyalty that Maridos Marquez showed to Chief Justice Corona at the time, you know, openly defending him, talking as if you were like a personal spokesperson, would be the same kind of action you would expect from any other court spokesman now?
Yeah, I think first there was he committed some errors because the Chief Justice, I think, gave him also the wrong information. That's the case of Gloria Arroyo. Departure, remember, when there was some misinformation. So that's basically wrong. It's to give us, the public, wrong information. The second is, you're the spokesperson of the institution, not of the Chief Justice. Mm. So it's a very thin line, and it became too politicized. And the third is, Maridos Marquez interpreted the decisions of the court. That's a no-no. You just give the summary or the decision itself, like what Ted is doing now, there's a summary, but you don't interpret, because the decisions speak for themselves. Mm-hmm. That was three things wrong. I'm sorry.
Three things that you hope Teddy Ted doesn't do now.
No, he doesn't. He doesn't interpret.
Yeah.
He just made a confusion between status quo, anti-order,
correct,
and TRO.
Correct. Okay. Yes. That's the thing that should be avoided in the future.
All right. Well, lessons learned for everyone. associate justices and court spokesmen and court administrators just the same. Marites Vitug, thank you very much for joining
thank
us
you.
Tonight.
Thanks.
Again, sharing your observations with us on how the judiciary has moved on since the impeachment of Chief Justice Corona.